Today we are at the Glen Hazel Hebrews Congregation. So for the Bible, I'm a Judah. We are with the Jewish people. We are documenting how they eat, they dress, how they sing. Welcome to Isigo, your new favorite show. Let's go.
In 1652, the Dutch began the first permanent European settlement of South Africa under Jan van Riebeck as a representative of the Dutch East India Company. A number of non-professing Jews were among the first settlers of Cape Town in 1652. Despite restrictions against the immigration of non-Christians, religious freedom was granted by the Dutch colony in 1803. Asambenzi ufunda ukuthi ama Jews aphila kanjani and whether it's a culture or religion.
Hello, my name is Simpiwe Ngema and you are still here with me. Join me as I interview Rabbi Michael Katz. You know, guys, that we are talking Jewish today. Welcome to our show, sir.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
I'd like to know, what is Judaism?
Judaism is a culture. Judaism is a religion. But perhaps the best way to describe Judaism is it's an entire way of life that really has something to say about every dimension, every facet, every part of our lives, and primarily how we connect with God. And Judaism is this full, rich, and beautiful way of life that gives us an incredible and beautiful way of looking at the entire world.
In other cultures, other African cultures, there are chiefs and leaders. Do you also have that in the Jewish culture?
Well, the word rabbi means teacher. But traditional Judaism, classical Judaism, really had the idea of kings. That there was a king who was the supreme leader. And the king was in charge of just about everything. But there was also a priesthood. And the priests were at the pinnacle, at the top of the entire people with regards to their relationship with God, work in the temple, and so on. There was always some kind of a hierarchy. So there was the political or military, which really fell under the king, and then there was the priesthood. Now, interestingly enough, there are priestly families within Judaism. A priestly family we would call Kohanim, a Kohen.
Wow. I actually have just one more question. What is the transition from being a young person to being a woman or a man? Do you have certain customs with regards to that?
We have a ceremony that is called Bat Mitzvah for a girl, which means the daughter of the mitzvah. I'll explain in a moment what a mitzvah is.
Okay.
And then we have Bar Mitzvah, which is the son of the mitzvah. What does it mean? At that age of 12 and 13, now it's interesting, with girls it's younger than boys. And why? Because we believe, and it's stated fact, that girls mature at a younger age. A 12-year-old girl and a 13-year-old boy should more or less be on a par from the point of being able to take responsibility. And now this is not responsibility for their lives. At age 12 or 13, they can't yet get married. They can't yet drive a car. There's a whole lot of things that they shouldn't be doing, but maybe are doing at 12 or 13, but they shouldn't be. But they are responsible here for what we call the mitzvah. Mitzvah is the commandments. A child under the age of bar or bat mitzvah, when they're below 12 or 13, can't yet comprehend the difference between right and wrong, what these things are actually all about. At age 12 or 13, you can get through to them. And at that coming of age, they take responsibility for those precepts. They take responsibility for being the Jew that they're supposed to be at that age. And that ceremony that takes place is a beautiful ceremony where we actually have the coming of age ceremony different girls to boys. Boys come into the synagogue, and in the synagogue, in the shul, they're called up to read from the Torah, from the scriptures themselves. Mm-hmm. Girls, it's done much more in a feminine fashion, in a woman's fashion, usually a ceremony that is done very often together with a whole group of girls of the same age. And they are very, very beautiful traditions, and makes the man a man, and the girl and the woman a girl. But really, as I said, it's all got to do with their responsibility to the religion.
You have to learn about different cultures, different religions. Instead of us competing, we just have to understand each other. Don't go away. I'm really learning a lot about the Jewish culture. So, we have learned about the structure of the church and the different ceremonies that are observed for both boys and girls, and also why they are done. Asizweni ukuthi abantu besifazane bamaJuda baphila kanjani. I am here with Bridget, and she is going to tell me more about being a Jewish woman and the rules. Hi, how are you?
Hi.
Welcome to our show, Isigo.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. I'd like to know, what is the role of a woman in the Jewish community?
Well, a woman in the Jewish community really is someone who is what we call the foundation of the home. So she sets the tone in the home and very much is the life force and the strength behind her husband, behind her children. She's the one who inspires them. She's the one who helps keep them strong and uplift them spiritually.
And in my culture, the Zulu culture, there's a bride price, which is called lobola, before you get married. Do you guys have anything like that? Do you give gifts to the family of the bride or the family of the groom when you get married?
There isn't any monetary exchange that we practice today. What happens is that the husband gives the wife what's called a ketubah. Okay. And it's really like a document which enumerates all his responsibilities to her
now
that he is married to
her. That sounds very interesting. Are you allowed to marry outside your religion or culture?
We're not permitted to marry outside of the Jewish faith. It's a great prohibition.
Okay.
As far as we understand, a Jewish person should marry a Jewish person.
Okay.
If a person were to meet a non-Jewish person, at first they'd probably be discouraged from marrying them.
Okay.
If the non-Jewish person feels that they could have a great commitment to a Jewish way of life, that this is something that they feel passionate about, then they'd have to go through the process of doing a conversion through what's called the Beit Din, which is the official body of like the judges of the Jewish community in each different city. And it's a long process. People are generally discouraged from converting to Judaism rather than encouraged because it has to be a full commitment. And it's not the easiest way of life.
Guys, you heard it. You can do your hair, at least as long as it's not your real hair if you're married. So you can still be fashionable and stylish, and there's a lot that you've learned. I mean, come on. But now, right now, I would like to go learn more about the music and the food.
Elohe Abraham, Elohe Yitzchak, Elohe Yaakov.
Moshe, you sing Jewish music. What made you choose to go that route?
Like all young people, I love a host of music. Being a believer of the Jewish faith, there's something about the different styles of Jewish music, particularly myself, connect to, and I think others connect to as well, which I particularly enjoy.
If there's someone who would like to sing Jewish music out there, who is young and thinks it's uncool, what would you say to them?
There's so many different platforms that you can get involved with, be it in your local synagogue, wherever you want, really. In the Jewish faith, you've got so many different places to sing and be involved with Jewish music. So there's great places. It doesn't have to be the same old, same old. You can put your own twist on it and connect to the tradition in your own specific way. I sing for a Jewish ceremony band and function band as well. We comprise of a group of three of us for Jewish ceremonies, and then for functions we have four of us. So that's basically called the Chuppah Band. and we sing for different Jewish couples, and it's really great to be a part of someone's big day and play the role that we play to help people connect to the moment by playing really good music that they choose.
So do they like play your music at clubs maybe, or is it just
really
at church and weddings?
You won't really hear us up in the club, but you can hear us at different weddings. We are shortly coming up with some music videos as well, so you can hear us over there. But yeah, mainly at primarily at weddings and other Jewish functions, and in synagogues as well for different functions as well.
Yes, we are still here learning about the Jewish culture. What I want to know is, how do they have fun?
There is no shortage of entertainment. Jewish culture, just experiencing the Jewish religion itself, there's so much, so to say, fun that's part of it. It's fundamental to our religion to have fun. And in fact, there's an expression, we must serve God with joy. So you always have to find the joy of life. And in fact, although it's not officially considered a sin to be melancholy, morose, downtrodden, but being in that lugubrious down state is not advisable in Judaism. We gotta always be upbeat, find the joy of Judaism. Singing is an important part of our culture. And just in general, being happy, it's always better to be that way.
So we are always turning up here. And what I'd like to know, as a Jewish boy growing up, did you feel like there are any restrictions?
Well, it depends how you look at it. Certainly within Judaism, we have in the Torah, in the Bible, which is the foundation of Jewish law, the 613 commandments, 248 positive commandments, and 365 negative. Like, don't steal, don't kill, don't commit adultery, those types of things, the negative ones. So certainly there are restrictions. Let's take, for example, the Shabbos, or I don't know how other people know it, as the Sabbath, as they would say it in the States where I'm coming from, or Shabbat. That is the seventh day of each week. We rest, we refrain from work. One could see it as a restriction. Oh my gosh, I can't check my email, can't use my cell phone, can't turn on the light, can't tune into the news. Or you could see it as, what a blessing, a beautiful day we have, where you don't need to be obstructed with all this nonsense of the world, where you don't have to be, your mind could be at ease, at rest, because you don't have all those problems. So I think that's about a mindset. Is it a restriction, or is it a way to enhance your life? We can't eat certain foods, but that's also a blessing, because there are certain benefits to these dietary restrictions. So one could see their diet as restricting them, or as keeping them healthier. And that's all about your mindset, your perspective, how you see things.
That is interesting. Guys, you heard it. No Twitter, no Facebook, no Instagram, nothing on Sabbath. And it is just about you celebrating yourself. I'd like to know, you said that there's going to be an event that's coming up in 2 weeks. Tell me more about that.
Well, the event is called Chanukah. The name Chanukah itself is an acronym of two Hebrew words, Chanu, which means they rested, Chaf Hei, which is the second part of it, on the 25th of the Hebrew month of Kislev. And it's a beautiful celebration. It's an 8-day festival, so instead of one day of presents, we get eight awesome
days. That is a big turn up.
Exactly. And Chanukah, in short, is a story that happened about 2,500 years ago, when our temple stood in Jerusalem, and we were invaded by a foreign Greek army. Not to be confused with contemporary Greek people, we don't have any, you know, no problem today. No. But back then, there was this invasion, and there were restrictions, and there were certain frictions. They invaded our temple, they defiled the menorah, which was a candelabra that was lit every day. Now, the purpose of the candelabra wasn't just to have light inside the temple, but rather it was about realizing that each person is a lamplighter. You and I and everyone watching, we're all lamplighters. We have to bring light into the world. And so in the temple, the menorah that was lit every day, what's very interesting is we didn't need that light in the temple because there were lots of candelabras and beautiful lamps. This was to remind us to give light into the world. And that's why the windows in the temple were built in a very interesting way. Ancient windows were built narrow on the outside, wide on the inside, bringing as much light as possible in. And the temple was the opposite. It was narrow on the inside, wide on the outside, to show it's about illuminating the world around you. We know how crazy the world is. And each one of us could be a lamplighter, could really illuminate our surroundings, make the world a much brighter, more beautiful place.
So very interesting. Could you also tell us more about the paintings and everything that you have here?
So on the festival of Chanukah, we light the menorah to commemorate a great miracle that happened 2,500 years ago.
As we mentioned in the temple, they would kindle the menorah every day. Now, it was a six-branch menorah, but you notice this one has eight branches. And that is because the way the menorah was lit was with pure extra virgin olive oil. Now, the invading Greek army, what they did was they actually defiled the oil. They spilled all the oil out, so we didn't have oil. Now, they were searching all over for the oil, and miraculously, they found one cruse, one jug of olive oil.
Wow.
Now, the thing is, it would take another week until they were able to take the olives and crush them and manufacture, produce, you're talking about 2,500 years ago, to produce sufficient olive oil to kindle the menorah. Well, you only have one day's worth of oil. What are you going to do? They lit the menorah, and guess what happens? Miracle of miracles. Although it was only one day's worth of oil, it lasted for 8 days.
Wow.
So today, we kindle our menorah, and we light it for 8 nights, celebrating the festival of Hanukkah, remembering that great miracle. Now think about it today. We got our mobile phones. It hardly even lasts 1 day.
Exactly.
Now imagine it lasts 8 days. That would be a modern miracle.
Mine doesn't last even 2 hours.
You know, Judaism is all about reliving and experiencing the miracles, the stories that happened to our ancestors, all those events of the past. We recall them today in live time. And so we do lots of different customs and things to remember that. So here we go. This is called sufganiyot, potato pancakes. We call them latkes. We make all types of oily kind of foods that we eat on the festival of Hanukkah. So donuts or other types of foods made with oil, recalling the miracles of the oil. There's also cheese because that was also part of the miracle story. And we remember it by actually implementing that as part of our fun foods that we eat on the festival. Here's a fun game we play. It's called dreidel. And the dreidel is a four-sided little spinning thing. And it has four letters on it. And we play fun games with it. And the reason was because back then, it was forbidden for Jews to observe their culture, their religion. And so they would hide out in caves, and they would study. But when the authorities came and saw, what are you doing? They would quickly hide their books. They would take out these little tops, and they'd spin their dreidels. They'd play the game. The letters on it are Nun Gimel He Shem, which is an acronym for Nes Gadal Hayasham, which means a great miracle happened there. And so when you play the game, if your top lands on the Gimel, that's like grand, big, you win big. You win whatever the money arrangement is in the middle. If it lands on the Nun, you get nothing. If it lands on the Hay, you get half the pot. And if it lands on the Shem, well, then you got to put in. And it's a fun game, but it reminds us of the past. And that's about the fun of Judaism. Judaism is always about reliving the experience, but in a fun and enjoyable way. And of course, there are some serious times, too. We take it very serious, but that's part of Judaism. There are the serious moments, but we have to have a lot of joy as well. And so the festival of Hanukkah is a very joyous time.
There's been a lot of talking about food, and y'all know, what did I say? I love food, so I'm getting hungry. You can catch me later after the break while I'm going to eat.
Kashrut is the word given to the whole set of Jewish food laws, which are found in the Torah. These laws have been developed through the ages by the rabbis. Let's take a look and a bit of a bite of traditional Jewish food.
Welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
Could you please tell us, why do we have prepared here?
Well, we've got on the table traditional Jewish starters, and then some foods that we're going to serve for the Hanukkah festival, the Festival of Lights. What you just had is a dish called gefilte fish, which is made from a minced fish that you poach, and you poach for a couple of hours, let it cool down. That's what you've had over there. And we add to that, we add a bit of bread, we add a bit of sugar, salt, pepper, and depending on your tradition, some people have it sweet, some people have it a little bit salty. So that's the gefilte fish. So this is chopped herring. So now chopped herring, you've got to eat the kibble. And you have a little bit of that, now try that. And have a bite of it with the kibble. And that's chopped herring and kibble.
This tastes amazing. And what do we have here?
Now that I believe you won't eat. You don't eat cheese.
Yes, guys. Okay. Cheese I need. Just get a lot of cheese.
So this is also a very traditional Jewish dish, served at a breakfast or at a time of celebration, at an engagement party, at a bris, something like that. Very traditional. It's basically, instead of having a cheesecake, this would be the same filling as a cheesecake, but wrapped up in a pancake, and that's a cheese blintzer. Those are potato latkes. It's a deep fried potato fritter. So it's got the flour and the onions, again, a bit of sugar. Also very traditional, very yummy.
This is some good food.
So when the guys buy fat cook on the street, it's better than fat cook.
Way better.
And these are donuts. Everybody knows a donut. So really traditional this time of year to eat it coming up next week, start of the Festival of Lights, Hanukkah, where we eat fried food to symbolize the oil of the menorah of the candle. Also, when we make the donuts, we don't have any animal fat in the donut, or we don't have any dairy product in the donut. It's what we call karev, because you can't mix meat and milk.
Is there a specific reason why you can't mix the two?
It says in Genesis, you can't cook a calf in the mother's milk. And from that we create the tradition has come down that when we can't mix meat and milk in anything that we do. So think of a cheeseburger.
No cheeseburgers here, guys. No cheeseburgers. Burgers, no problem. But cheeseburgers. From Mina, Usim Chovo, Sim Kat, Sim Zonke, No Lebu, No Rob, No King, No Ras, No Mandla City Chovo, from Isigo Yonke. Bye bye, thank you, son.